the lifelong debate on my channel. ASCII or Pygame? Well, why not both? In my latest video, we covered the topic of procedural map generation for ASCII games, at least my own implementations. Lots of you were interested about how it would look when created with Pygame. And since my Python classes tutorial received amazing traffic recently, I decided to merge everything together to create something minimalistic that we can start calling a game. So stay with me along this video and you'll see how I managed to create the same game using only the Python console versus creating a graphical window. This is not a Code With Me tutorial, although I'll show most of the scripts to help you understand the step-by-step process. So let's start with the map generation. Instead of fancy algorithms, I came up with a simple idea. First, we create an empty map that only contains grass or field tiles. Then, to make it somewhat customizable from the codebase, I created a patch generating method that can be used to replace parts of the map with specific tile groups. We can set the number of patches and their approximate sizes for any type of tile we already created. To make it more lifelike, I randomized the start and width of each row. All of this I covered in my tutorial, so if you're interested in the process, be sure to take a look. Now we have the procedural map generation. The next step was to add the player that can move around the map. That's pretty easy, we just need a player object with coordinates and a method that can calculate all the possible movement directions. To display the player, I use two different maps. An initial static one that will never change after the generation, and a deep copy of that where we override the tile that the player stands on with the marker of the player. Now it's time to spice things up. About 2 years ago, I created an ASCII game, Bane of Orcs. That was the first time when I implemented map exploration and dynamic legend. These are cool features that I wanted to include in this demo as well. So, to explore the map, the first step is to create a matrix of zeros with the dimensions of the map. This will be the exploration process. Zeros for unknown tiles and ones for explore tiles. When displaying the map, we take this into account. As we iterate through the map data, which is a list of lists, we check the corresponding value in this exploration matrix and we show the map tile if the value is 1. Otherwise, we show an empty tile, which is simply a space. So whenever we move on the map, we update this exploration matrix and switch the 0 on the coordinate of the player to 1. What's even better is that you can create the illusion of vision around you by not only switching the tile where the player is on, but all the tiles around it in a circle. For this, we just need a couple more for loops and a vision matrix. To show the legend on the map, first we need a list where we store all the tiles we already discovered. Upon movement, we add any new tile types that we come across. Then we modify the displaying part to show the legend after printing the specific row of the map. All map and movement related features are implemented, let's see the battle. Again, if you're interested in the step-by-step tutorial of how to create this battle functionality, feel free to take a look at it after this video. The battle mechanics are pretty simple. It's a turn-based combat where the player fights the enemy until one of them dies. For the visuals, I created dynamic hotbars so we can see what's going on. Creating enemies is as easy as it can be, as the enemy class is already implemented. To make the battle concept extendable, I featured RPG elements like equipping or dropping weapons, but that's not the concern of this video. With each step, we have a specific chance to encounter an enemy, resulting in a fight. The battle itself is another loop in the main game loop that lasts until one of the combatants lose all their health points. We are almost done with the ASCII version. To make it more extendable for other game modes, we should create a game class that all the different modes will inherit from. This is important since the modes will have lots of things in common, yet the main loop will be different. The main difference is that the console version is one input per iteration, while the Pygame version is continuous iteration and input logging. Let's talk about the Pygame version now. Thankfully, the core of the game is already developed, we just need to write the code for displaying and the input. In the setup of this game mode, we should initialize Pygame first. Then we calculate the size of the window based on the number of tiles and their dimensions. I'll put the map tiles on a separate layer. It's not necessary, but this way I can move them together if I decided to put the map somewhere else inside the window. For the sake of this video, I drew some cute tiles that we can put onto the map. We already have our tile objects created, so let's extend them by adding image attributes and a method to load that specific image. Then we will call this method for all map tiles only if we start the Pygame version. The run method will look a bit different. I usually check for events first, then handle updates and displaying. The map movement will be similar to the ASCII version, but we use key presses instead of string inputs. To display the map on the screen, I iterate through the map data first, and if the tile is explored, I bleed it to the extra layer, then bleed that layer to the screen. To show the possible movement directions, I use this text drawing method. Now, the code is pretty simple, but we still have to add the battle. Unlike the ASCII mode with the fight loop, we store the enemy as an attribute of the game class. But we can't just spawn it anywhere in the loop, we should only prompt it when we take a step, so I put it inside the keypress events. And now we can use this enemy as a switch for inputs and displaying. Obviously, if we are in combat, we don't want to move on the map, but rather fight, so the input is limited. And whenever the enemy falls, we remove it from the attribute, so the fight is over. As for the UI, I display the attack prompt instead of the movement options when we have an enemy to fight. Additionally, to have visual information about the battle scene, I created simple hellbars with outlines and values in the middle. To make it visually more appealing, I created some background frames that can be used as the part of the UI. Since this is just a demo, I didn't bother making it scalable with the tile numbers, so I drew it with a static size. But of course, it wouldn't be difficult either to slice up the image and scale the parts of it compared to the window. And that's most of the Pygame mode. Now we have two separate game modes, but what if I told you, we can even make both of them run in parallel? That's definitely something we can do. Since this combined mode would use the same graphics that we already implemented, I simply inherit it from the Pygame mode. The main question is that how can we modify the run method to solve the issue of console display? Same like the map movement before, we should only update the console whenever we do something. But to have something in the console before we make any actions, we should display the map, the health bar, and the movement options. Apart from this, it's almost identical. We just need to add some stuff to the events. That is, clearing the screen, displaying the map, and based on the situation, displaying the enemy health bar or the movement options. And with that, our game now has two different modes and the combination of them. One last thing to do is to let the user decide which mode to start. If we start our application from the console, we have the opportunity to pass arguments that we can parse with the code. The first argument after Python is always the file that we want to run, and the second one can be used to decide the game mode. To make it the shortest, I wrapped it in a try-exe block, so if I type python run.py ASCII, it will start the ASCII mode. If I type anything else, like python run.py something, it will start the Pygame mode. And if I don't provide additional arguments, this would result in an index error, but I catch it and start the game in combined mode. Of course, I could have implemented something like if game mode is equals to Pygame or combined or something else, then do this, but this one works just fine and I don't need to type anything extra to start the combined mode, and even better, I can just double click the file. Well, I hope you enjoyed the video and learned a bunch of new stuff. I'm always happy to teach you guys. And apologies that it took so long, I'm trying to get back on track with a lot of things going on right now. But yeah, thanks a lot, feel free to leave some feedback and subscribe for more. Stay safe and take care.